morning, my presentation is titled Economic Literacy, Understanding the Barbadian Economy. Now, don't get worried about this very super looking technical diagram. I'm gonna explain it to you. An economy is pretty much a mechanism or a system where resources which are scarce are allocated among, I will not even say competing agents, but economic agents, which are households, firms, and also other members of the economy, which is the financial sector, the government sector, and the external sector. So what the diagram below shows, if you look at the top, you have households and firms. Now, households are what you represent. You individuals live home, you have families, you have children, you have kids, some who are working, you have grandchildren who are working, and some of you are still working even in your retirement. But you all, there are also firms which form part of this economic system. Now, what the firms do is that they hire you, which is a resource, because you provide a specific skill or a service to them, which they pay you for. Now, obviously, by you providing your skill or service, they pay you in return, but at the same time, they produce an output. So the resources you provide in this economy are the skills and services that you would have learned over the years at university, SJPP, learning online, even on the job. And in return for that, the firm produces an output, but also provides income to you. Now, obviously, what happens to this income as the income that you get from the firms, you actually spend on other goods and services, which then go back into the same firms. These firms can be manufacturing companies, restaurants, hotels, retail stores, especially for the ladies who love to do retail therapy between, and stuff like that. But then when you look at the bottom four, the bottom three, you see the financial sector, the government sector, and the external sector. Now, the financial sector is what represents the financial institutions. Obviously, injections in the financial system will be investments, which also can even come from your pockets, where you invest into the banks, or you insurance companies, or even investing in government securities and stuff like that. However, there are leakages. What we call by leakages is money that is taken out of the economy. And this is usually done through savings. So when you save a portion of your income, which I would advise you to do, you're actually taking that out of the economy from spending. So you obviously will have your savings or whatever else is left is your disposable income to spend. Now the government sector, which we will definitely be getting into later on in my presentation, better known as the public sector, is where there's public spending by government, where government will spend on healthcare, education, wages, and salaries. And by doing that, they stimulate economic growth. However, what government does on the flip side is that in terms of leakages, they will tax you, whether personal income taxes, whether taxes of corporations and companies, even VAT excise taxes. So obviously they take it back out. And then the last part is the external sector, actually where I work, specifically a central bank, where exports. Now, most persons in Barbados would know that we provide tourism, but I don't think most persons in Barbados know that based on the IMF classification, tourism on the external sector is considered a service. It's actually not a good, it's a service. So when persons come here to Barbados to stay in the hotels, usually regardless of if they swipe their cards overseas or not, we are providing a service to them which we usually receive in foreign exchange. Also, we export goods such as rum, a lot of rum actually. Before it used to be a lot of sugar, but that has fallen off over the last two decades. But then on the flip side, most Barbadians should know that we import most of the goods that we consume, at least about 80%. It might even be more, but we usually import most of the goods that we consume in some form or fashion, and we even import services. So what are the characteristics of the Barbadian economy? Now, some of you would have heard over the years that Barbados is considered a small open economy with a fixed exchange rate. What we mean by small, we don't necessarily mean the size of the country in square miles. But what we mean is that the domestic economy or the domestic economic activity generated from businesses and even persons like yourself does not significantly impact domestic or even foreign prices. So regardless of what we do here, we cannot really influence foreign prices. We actually are price takers, especially as it relates to the international market. Open. Barbados is a country that is open to international trade, not only of goods, but of services. And obviously, one of our biggest services that we provide to the globe is tourism. But we also import goods and other services. Fixed exchange rate. Everyone knows that we have a fixed exchange rate, which is $2 Barbados to $1. Now, further on in the presentation, you will actually see how the government of Barbados actually tries to maintain this fixed exchange rate. Now, Barbadian economy is divided into four sectors. It's the rail sector, the balance of payment sector, the public sector, which is both fiscal and debt, and the financial sector. Now, the rail sector is concerned with rail GDP, tourist arrivals, which feed into tourism GDP. Also, retail and manufacturing, how that is done on the ground, if manufacturing is producing any output. But then also, we have the balance of payments, which is concerned with the inflows and outflows of foreign exchange, whether with goods, services, or even in the case of financial assets. Public sector, which is where most persons are usually concerned with right now in Barbados, is the fiscal and the debt. Obviously, even though they're technically two sectors, they're considered one because they work in hand with each other. As you will see later in the presentation, the debt actually helps finance the fiscal. And then you have the financial sector. Now, between these four sectors, the rail sector actually feeds into all the other three, and then each of these sectors feed into each other. Now, I think this might be slightly too, actually it's not that small. But GDP, everyone in here usually has heard about GDP, better known as gross domestic product. Now, what GDP is defined as is the total value added generated in the process of producing goods and services within an economy, which generates economic activity over a specific period of time. Now, there are two versions of GDP, or two variations. There's nominal GDP and there's real GDP. Now, nominal GDP is the total value of goods and services produced in an economy during a given period of time. However, it is measured in current prices. So year on year, regardless to what you produce, the Central Bank of Barbados will usually, through the Statistics Department, calculate nominal GDP, but based on current prices every year. And I must say that the Statistical Service plays a very important role in this calculation. Now, in terms of real GDP now, which everyone usually hear, you will hear, the governor might say the real GDP has contracted by 0.5% or 0.6%. The difference between real GDP and nominal is that the only thing that change that does not change is prices. So for instance, the total value of goods and services produced in the economy during a given period of time is measured at constant prices. So the prices does not change. Now the reason this is done is to adjust for inflation. Now, I don't know how many persons in here know this, but inflation actually has a serious impact on economic activity. Now, persons in here or persons like my parents will always complain about the cost of living. Like they used to be like, but I can't understand why this price increase, or then why the price decrease of this good, but then it jumped back up. That is actually linked to inflation. But as we will go further in the presentation, you will see exactly what inflation is and what are the possible causes of it. Now, before I go any further, a lot of persons sometimes get mixed up between what is growth and what is development. And they work hand in hand, but they're not the same thing. So economic growth is an expansion in a country's ability, such as Barbados, to produce goods and services. Usually when you have economic growth, that means it's positive, is an increase from year to year. However, if economic growth is negative, is a contraction, that means a decrease from 1 year to the next. So for instance, economic growth, this is an example. Let me say economic growth last year was 2%. That would have been 2% compared to 2018. Now, what are the roles in government promoting growth? Government provides infrastructure and also invests in it. Roads, new buildings, hospitals, building polyclinics, building libraries, building schools. All of these form part of government's infrastructure to help promote growth, not even right now, but in the future. But government also provides incentives not only to local investors, but foreign investors. One thing Barbados is benefits a lot from a lot of other Caribbean countries is because of our educational advances, and especially even in technology. When a lot of persons come here, they're quite surprised how technologically advanced we are. For instance, as everybody would have known, during COVID, most companies in Barbados were still able to function as normal. In my case, as a disclaimer, and you know this is being recorded, I actually worked harder home than when I was at work. And my mom couldn't understand, so anyway, she would call me at work, way I would tell her, call her back, and then she saw it sometimes in the morning, get at 7, and they worked about 10 o'clock straight. Different meetings and stuff with my other colleagues working on updating the model and doing stuff for the governor and other requests. But also what the government does is that it provides support and finance for businesses. Obviously, we live in a climate right now which might not be the best because of COVID, but government always tries to provide support and finance, even if it's in grants, to try to stimulate a business climate or even to get back things to where it was before. The job of government is extremely hard, and regardless to which administration it in, is an extremely hard job. I've been able to work for both, and I can say it is an extremely hard job. Now, development is a process of improving the quality of living of a country's population. So for instance, the late Right Honorable Errol Barrow would have made a decision years ago before he was born to push free education. Because of that, we're still seeing the benefits now of that decision, because we have so many persons in Barbados who have been educated, with some of you who have gone on to do extremely great things. We have persons who have gone overseas and worked for Fortune 500 companies and have come back and given their experience to help in helping the development of the country, even technologically advancing our IT infrastructure. Then another part of development is creating conditions conducive to increasing people's self-esteem and even increased freedom to choose. For instance, healthcare is very important. Barbados is one of the few countries in the Caribbean that I know of where we have free education, we have free healthcare. And as a guy told me in St. Kitts, he point blank told me, how are we supposed to be able to compete with you guys when you're doing that? But the truth is that development and economic growth are not the same, but they go hand in hand. When you raise the standard of living of your people, this feeds into years later of economic growth. Now, inflation. Some of you would have heard the term inflation during the press release. You might hear the governor of the central bank talk about it. You might hear the IMF or even the international news. All inflation really is the increase in the general level of prices of goods and services. That is all it is, inflation. Deflation is the reverse, when prices decrease. Now, what are some of the causes of inflation, especially even with a country like Barbados? Increasing commodity prices such as oil. Now, I don't know if most persons in here know this, but when oil prices usually go up, that actually has a significant impact on the Barbadian economy directly, and indirectly. One, the value of imports automatically go up because one, we import about 40% of our imports are about fuel, but then the other remaining, which are goods, fuel plays a component in getting the goods here and even being produced in the international market. And fuel is so important. So like, for instance, if those countries have a sneeze, we can get a couple coughs or a nice cold because we are small and open and we are price takers. Changes in regulated prices are utilities. Obviously, we have utility companies here, and usually maybe there are cases when they will want a rate increase. So obviously, this doesn't really happen here, but in other international markets, regulated prices can seriously impact not only just the price that you pay of your electricity bill and utility bills, but even what you pay for goods and services. Changes in taxes and subsidies. Now, when inflation occurs, and I was glad for the presenter that came before me, for you that are retired, especially you that guys that don't have income coming in like before, inflation significantly impacts you. I see it even personally with my parents, medication, you want to go to the supermarket, you have $100. If the price is increasing, if you used to spend $50, you might be spending $60 for the same basket of goods. So when inflation occurs, your purchasing power as a consumer is affected and you lose value for the dollars that you have. Now, the problem with inflation is that there is actually something called deflation, where the prices become cheaper, but then sometimes the spillover doesn't occur exactly at the same time. You might see a decrease in prices 3 months from now or even 6 months from now. Now, unemployment. Now, I know this has become a very topical subject right now, especially with COVID and many hotels being closed for a period of time, restaurants closing, small stores closing. As part of my job at the Central Bank of Barbados, I usually liaison with a couple other economists and touch base with different people in the economy. I don't need to read the news to know that unemployment is increasing. I just know that because of the persons I will call. Now, most persons will say unemployment are persons that don't work. But it's exactly, that's not really definition. We can bring it home. Unemployment is an economic condition marked by the fact that there are individuals actively seeking work. And they say actively seeking work who remain unemployed. The reason I am using that technical definition is that as someone I went through this presentation with last night, they said, so what about some of the guys that choose not to work? Our ladies, I was like, they can't be counted as unemployed because they are not seeking unemployment. And sometimes persons get a little bit confused with that. Now, the unemployment rate is a ratio. It is one thing I want you to get here is this definition. The unemployment rate is a ratio of unemployed people on the total labor force. Now, the total labor force will represent those who are unemployed and seeking or actively seeking employment added to those who are already working. Well, we kind of went through this diagram before, but pretty much this shows you the linkages between the different sectors and honestly, real feeds into all of them. So when GDP is declining, that feeds into the other sectors, the balance of payments, the debt, the financial, and the fiscal. So for instance, when economic activity is declining, obviously you would expect at the commercial banks your deposits to be declining. Especially if you have so many people unemployed, like in the current climate like this, you would not expect deposits at the commercial banks to still be what they were pre-COVID. Fiscal deficit, fiscal surplus, primary surplus. Obviously, government was expecting revenues to be a certain amount before COVID. which would have been hinged or directly linked to personal income taxes and corporate taxes, where a certain amount of persons would have been working. Since you have higher unemployment, obviously that is going to have a serious impact on the fiscal. Same thing with the balance of payments. Lower economic activity definitely will show, especially in tourism, where under the BOP, as we call it, balance of payments, you have something called travel credits, which doesn't only include the tourists that come here, but also students and also persons who come here for healthcare. We have clinics in Barbados who do a fantastic work to many non-residents and persons within the Caribbean. The debt, as the GDP is declining, there's a possibility that in the future, that obviously we could have to accumulate more debt to service not only our fiscal, but to help generate economic activity. Now, what is the balance of payments? I'm not going to spend a lot of time here because this, as simple as it is, this is not really the focus of this presentation. But the balance of payments is a statistical statement that summarizes transactions between residents and non-residents during a specific period of time. Now, residents does not mean only Barbadians. Residents can mean persons who have economic interest or their center of economic interest is within Barbados for at least a period of a year or more indefinitely. Well, non-residents would be any person who is a year or less. The BOP doesn't capture the impact of embassies, armies, and certain international organizations. Embassies such as the United States Embassy is still considered part of American soil. It's still considered part of America. Well, these are the accounts of the balance of payments. So I don't know if any of you ever heard about something called the current account deficit or the current account balance. But what feeds into that is the goods and services account, the primary account, the secondary account. The main driver in the current account is actually the goods and services balance. So the goods and services balance can be split into the import and exports of goods and the import and exports of services. We import a majority of what we consume, so obviously our merchandise balance in terms of goods is negative. Now, on the services side, Barbados is heavily tourism dependent. So obviously, even now in the current climate like this, where we don't have much tourists here, the services balance has been severely impacted. And as a result, that would cause a current account deficit. We also have the primary income, where we have companies here who are foreign direct owned, who at points in time will remit dividends to overseas companies, or even some companies here who own companies in other territories or other parts of the globe who receive dividends from their subsidiaries in other countries. We also, on the primary account, is where rental of property, if you have a property overseas and you remit the money back here, is recorded under primary income, and the same thing if it was the other way around. Secondary income is usually current transfers. For instance, the Barbados government, from time to time, hasn't happened recently, will receive something called like a current transfer from a European Union or the another multilateral organization, where they're given this funding, but they don't have to pay it back. And that's considered a current transfer, but better known as something called a grant. The capital and financial account is where most of the financial transactions occur, especially, for instance, the IMF funding that we receive, that's captured under the financial account. So when that is growing, that means we are receiving funding from the multilaterals, such as AADB, CDB, IMF, but also that can also contain real estate inflows. Most persons in Barbados should know that the real estate sector in Barbados is very pivotal in foreign exchange. Because we have international visitors that come here, eventually some of them do fall in love with the country, and they usually purchase a property or two, or they purchase a villa. And then some cases they sell their property to another non-resident or even to a local. Now, the gross international reserves. Has anybody heard about the term called international reserves before? You hear the governor talk about it. And I bet you're asking yourself, what on earth is this really used for? Now, the gross international reserves pretty much refer to the external assets that are readily available to and controlled by the monetary authorities to meet the balance of payments needs and maintain economic stability. Now, that's an economic term, and you're probably not going to remember that. Pretty much what the international reserves are, it is the holdings of foreign currency by the Central Bank of Barbados, which is used, and what I mean by balance of payments needs, that's the fund imports, which you directly feed into and indirectly, because there are persons in here who have subscriptions. As your presenter was saying before, manage your small subscriptions. Netflix and Hulu and all those things actually cost the Barbadian government, well, not Barbadian government, Barbadian economy, foreign exchange. So even though you're saying, oh, it's just 15 US, you know, that actually forms part of the international reserves. For instance, when you buy your stuff off of Amazon, especially that my mother who tends to window shop on Amazon every day and put stuff on her wish list. I don't think she's watching this, so this might not be a problem. But she, you know, she'll put her stuff in her wish list and she will wait until a certain time to then spend some money on some dresses and stuff that she found. And pretty much that is what feeds in to pulling down the reserves. We can even go further. When the government of Barbados has to pay back external debt, debt to multilaterals, debt to the capital markets, they actually pull down on the reserves. But let me not be a person of doom and gloom. On the flip side, the reserves can increase by foreign direct investment based on if we have developers who want to develop tourism projects and other projects within Barbados. We also have, for instance, our rum industry, even though it might be small, still does receive foreign currency because, especially in COVID, they can tell you that I believe, as if you would have gone around, that rum was maybe one of the premium items selling in most rum shops and most supermarkets. I actually saw a guy purchase 10 bottles, and I could not understand why during lockdown. But it seems, based on what I have been talking to people, both in Barbados and throughout the rest of the Caribbean region, that rum seems to be an item now persons are turning towards since they are home. Now, the import cover. Pretty much, you would have heard the import cover before. The import cover is just really the international reserves divided by the total imports of goods and services multiplied by 52 weeks. The reason they say 52 weeks is that they have 52 weeks in the calendar year. So if you take the gross international reserves or the reserves and divide it by the total imports and goods and services and multiply it by 52, you will get the import cover. Now, there is this debate if 12 weeks of cover is necessary, if you can go below. The truth is that, unfortunately, the community that I represent, not the central bank specifically, the international economic community, cannot really come to a clear conclusion of what is acceptable reserve cover. But the consensus among them has been 12 weeks or 3 months. Now, I will explain this to you why they possibly came up with it, but they cannot explain it. So Barbados is a small country, right? I'm not speaking for the rest of the countries in the world, but Barbados is a small open country. And we have seen the impact of COVID. We can't miss it. Persons are unemployed. Persons are on the radio saying they're looking for employment. The government now is trying to stimulate tourism again and stuff like that. The truth is that 12 weeks of cover is considered a good benchmark because don't look at 12 weeks of cover for what has happened before. Look at what it is going to be used for in the future. So we know we have imports. We have imports of goods. We have import of services. We also have debt to pay back to multilaterals. We have financial institutions who have also accumulated debt. So pretty much the consensus is if you have about 12 weeks, you should be able to cover at least 3 months in the future of your balance of payments needs. Now, obviously, by the time you get there, you should be accumulating more reserves and more reserves. in COVID, that is not exactly the case. And I don't even mean for Barbados, I mean for the world. If you read the international news, or you even look to our sisters to the, is it left or the right, Trinidad and Tobago, they have been severely impacted by decline in fuel prices. They, at a point in time, I think, had over 20 months of import cover. So 20 months. Now, let me just draw this to let you show you how important imports are. The average dollar value that is spent in imports, average for Barbados in a given week, is between 75 and 80 million Barbados dollars a week. Yeah, but don't worry, there's also inflows, right, that we receive. There are also inflows that we receive, but I just specifically talking about imports of goods and service on average. Some weeks it might be lower, but that's just to show you how important a reserve cover is important in Barbados. So if you take an average between 75 and 80 and multiply it by 12, you see how important the reserves are. And that is why it's an international indicator for not only policymakers and rating agencies, but even especially for foreign direct investors. Now, this is where everybody probably couldn't wait, and I made sure to try to cover this as much as possible. But this is the fiscal policy, or better known as the public sector or government. Now, public sector or fiscal policy is made up of four components of government, which are government's revenues, government's expenditure, the government's fiscal balance, and also primary surplus, and the government's debt. Now, fiscal instruments, we have revenue. Now, I know persons are going to complain about taxes and stuff like that, but that is how government gets its revenue. So we have two different types of taxes. We have direct and indirect taxes. Now, direct taxes are those taxes that are levied on individuals like myself who are still working, and even your grandchildren, friends of yours who are still working, but also firms that you purchase goods from, the banks, manufacturing companies, you name it. If it was a company, you get taxes levied on you. You can't get away. Now, the type of taxes that usually comprise direct taxes are the income taxes, which doesn't miss me for nothing. At least for 1 month, I would like it to miss me. The corporate taxes, which the corporations are taxed, and then for you that own homes, property taxes. Now, indirect taxes are those that are levied on goods and services. Everybody knows about VAT. There's also excises and their import duties, especially when you import your car, or you hear the garages say, well, you know, you look online and see, well, this car only costs like $6,000. What it costs this amount now? That's because of the import duties charged on the vehicle. We could get real technical, but that would take forever. Now, excises, you're wondering what excises are. Excises are usually taxes that are levied on fuel, tobacco, and alcohol. And despite the government levying taxes on alcohol and tobacco, the demand has not changed. Now, another fiscal set of instruments are expenditure. Now, government has current expenditures and also has capital expenditures. Now, current expenditures can be defined as the expenses that the government or the government of Barbados has to make regularly and at a specific point in time or specific intervals over a period of, especially like a year. Under current expenditures are wages and salaries. That is how government workers are paid. You have goods and services. Government has to purchase goods, whether toilet paper, new chairs, office supplies, even stuff such as for the COVID centers. The government had to spend a lot of money, especially to retrofit those facilities, but also in terms of the medication, the equipment, even though we would have received, as it was shown in the news, donations from the Chinese government at other territories. We have interest payments, which are both domestic and external. Interest payments for domestic are usually payments paid to financial institutions, NAS, who have holdings of government securities, and even yourself, who will have government securities. Transfers and subsidies is what government transfers to entities such as the QEH and other entities so they can continue to operate. Capital expenditure. The Prime Minister would have talked about this indirectly in the throne speech through the Governor General, but also previously throughout the year, especially around the BOSS program. Capital expenditure is usually expenditure spent on projects such as roads, even building new schools, and usually those projects would exist for a predetermined period of time. Now, this is where hopefully you remember some stuff. If you didn't remember some of the stuff I said before, this would be important. Everyone in here knows what is has heard about the fiscal deficit, correct? You hear the Prime Minister talk about it. You hear the Minister of Finance. You have heard everybody talk about it. It is an important indicator. What is the fiscal deficit? It is pretty much this. When government's revenue is less than what it spends, government is in a deficit. In other words, it's making a loss. When it's in a surplus, when their revenues are greater than their expenditure, they're in a surplus. However, I will caution you here, a fiscal deficit is not necessarily a bad thing. Government is the biggest employer of workers, and it also feeds into the economy of Barbados directly and indirectly through many channels. Too much to name. Obviously, because government is the main employer of workers, when you're paying those workers, you're still stimulating the economy because those workers are going to spend. By those workers going to spend, they're going to spend at supermarket, they can party, they can eat out. By they're doing that, then that money goes to the business and then it comes back around through taxation and stuff to the government. However, this is not the most important, I would not say it's the most important measure, but the fiscal balance or the fiscal deficit or surplus is actually used in conjunction with another term called primary surplus. All the primary surplus is that you subtract out the interest payments that government is making. Now, for anybody that has done accounting in here, all that really means is that government is subtracting out the interest payments in the current year. The reason that is done is because when you subtract out the interest payments, it gives the government a better gauge, or even you as someone looking on, how government is handling its finances and how much it will need in borrowing to finance its shortfall in revenue or its increase in expenditure. That is why under the IMF program, which I will tell you guys, read the books that are the publications by IMF, the primary surplus is a major indicator. The fiscal policy is the use of government spending and taxation to influence the economy. Now, you will either hear someone say, but government is having an expansionary fiscal policy, or government is having a contractionary fiscal policy. It's not as hard as it sounds. Pretty much, expansionary fiscal policy occurs when the government increases aggregate demand, which I mean aggregate demand, which is you guys and government workers, everybody in the economy, by increasing spending and reducing taxes. If I reduce your taxes, I guarantee you're going to spend more than you were spending before. Especially if I decrease it by a substantial amount, what was previously a want will now become a necessity in your mind. You have one pants that you wear once a month, you can say, let me buy three or four to still wear once a month. And that's just how it is. You have more disposable income. And government does that because they need the economy to be stimulated, so they do expansionary fiscal policy. However, when this is happening, the aggregate demand has increased, we tend to, the demand filters through to the supermarket, so we buy more stuff, then they have to import more goods than before. Then we go on Amazon and so many other websites and order more than before. You know what that does? Pull down the foreign reserves. So then, what government then will do on the flip side, maybe next year, is a contractional fiscal policy. All government will do now is decrease the demand by decreasing the spending and increasing taxes. So obviously then you're going to complain, say the tax is too high and you can't really survive. That's all it really is. And government has to do that sometimes. Not necessarily to slow down economic growth, but it can have an impact on inflation. And then, it could possibly overheat. And then the reserves will fall if we don't do a contractional fiscal policy. Now, fiscal policy is extremely important for an economy such as Barbados because we have a fixed exchange rate. Compared to some economies in the world, the monetary policy, which is done by central bank, doesn't have limitations, but because of the size of the country, we can only do so much at the Central Bank of Barbados. So for the reason, fiscal policy is really used as a tool to help, in many cases, as you have seen before, slow down aggregate demand. And at the same time, if you slow down aggregate demand of imports, obviously what will happen is that the fixed exchange rate, which is the 2-to-1, will not come under threat. Now, obviously, in 2018, before the election, after the election, leading up to that, you would have heard of many people on the call-in programs make the suggestion that we should go to a floating or flexible exchange rate. That could be a whole debate for other time, which you can invite me to speak on. But let's just say this. Barbados has benefited tremendously because of the fixed exchange rate we have had for years. And I don't think anybody in here will want it to change. Correct? Okay, good. See, you guys listening. Good. And hopefully my boss is watching so he can say, good job, Chris. So, fiscal expansion, or as we had an expansionary fiscal policy. Let me show you what's going to happen. Increased government spending, reduced taxes, so that's the upward arrow, leads to an increase in aggregate demand for imports. Another arrow goes up, foreign exchange, the demand of foreign exchange is increasing, and by that, the pressure is put on the exchange rate, which is the fixed peg, which all you guys just indicated to me, you don't want change. Now, what Sanae's government will do to maintain this is that they will intervene in the outflow of FX. Now, if government is doing a fiscal expansion, it is increasing the demand for imports. How would government get you to stop? I had it with contractional policy. That's how the government would do it, by contractional fiscal policy. Now, fiscal sustainability, I won't try to spend too much time here. It's pretty much when we refer to the ability for government to meet its financial and fiscal obligations without compromising the welfare of society. The government of Barbados, regardless to who is in power, always tries to make sure the elderly are not disadvantaged or put under severe pressure. Persons who will be considered poor, especially even with the providing of education and free healthcare, there are persons who cannot pay for free education, who cannot pay for education in Barbados if it was supposed to ever change. There are persons who cannot pay for the top service in healthcare that we receive here if that was supposed to change. So the government of Barbados is always faced with that to make sure that the less fortunate is not disenfranchised. And that is always usually a goal. As you would have realized, during the lockdown and during all the meetings, the Prime Minister would have transferred more money to different SOEs to make sure the elderly were not affected too much and that the needs of persons who could not do better, that they at least have some form of income coming in. Now, this is the fiscal deficit and growth. Now, this is going to show you how fiscal deficits, especially if they're a large kind of fat economic growth in Barbados. So when you have a fiscal deficit where the expenditure is greater than revenue, and usually in this case, the fiscal deficit can be, I would say, quite large, what that happens is that causes government now for their fiscal space to decline. What do I mean by fiscal space? This is pretty much a room in the budget for which the government can spend on public services, such as health, education, public projects, where most of you benefit from directly and indirectly, and your children, your grandchildren. So imagine if government had a smaller space to help with free education or subsidized education or with health care. We would be under more strain than we are now. And the reason this chart is very important, this graph, is that it shows you how hard it is for our government on a daily basis, in conjunction with the central bank, the Ministry of Finance, and many other persons who feed into economic growth and the economy, how important it is for us, for the government, to always look out for those who will always need assistance. However, what this then leads to, when you have a decline in fiscal space, is higher income taxes and corporation taxes. The only way you can get back the deficit smaller is by increasing your taxes. Or you cut your expenditure, which government tends to do also. Then what happens is, because of this, is that as the taxes increase, it crows in investment. Because you have less money in your pocket now, you can't invest as you like. You can't spend in the supermarket as you like. For companies in Barbados who will have a higher corporation tax, they may have had an idea of opening a new plant to do something, but because the taxes are higher, they will have to rethink that. What that does now, that affects economic growth through the channels of unemployment and being able to create new capital infrastructure. So that is why government tries to keep the fiscal deficit smaller and also the primary balance. Now, how is the fiscal finance? The fiscal is actually financed by the help of debt, both domestic, which you guys would have feed into directly and indirectly through savings bonds, treasury bills, debentures, but also through external financing, which is what we receive from the multilaterals. Now, what I would say here is that, especially for the multilateral financing, anytime we receive financing from them in the form of a public, we call it a public policy loan, or better known as a policy-based loan, better known as a PBL, that is usually used for some project. Now, obviously, the government of Barbados has undertaken work now to fix the roads in Barbados, fix the mains, and do other capital works. So some of the financing that we will receive will actually be used for that. You can't borrow money from these multilaterals and do nothing with it. It cannot stay there. It has to be used. And then government also receives foreign finances from other countries or through raising of sovereign bonds. And this is why debt to GDP is important. Now, when debt to GDP is rising, that is not usually a good indicator, because there's a possibility that might not be able to be financed in the long term. However, usually what happens is that a government can default or in some cases restructure part of their debt so that government can get back on a lower trend over a period of time. And they, under the BERT program with the IMF, that is what the government of Barbados has done. So years from now, we will be on a trajectory to reach about 60% of GDP, which is an acceptable level. So I would just like to say thank you, and hopefully you learn something.